Last Wednesday, Europe's venerable Ariane 5 rocket took to the skies for the last time in a historic launch from French Guiana in an extremely bittersweet moment for Europe and the entire space industry. For its final mission, the European workhorse delivered two satellites to a geostationary orbit almost 36,000 kilometers above Earth's surface. One of these satellites was a German space agency communications satellite, and the other a French military communications system. Now, contrary to what you might expect, I'm not actually a detractor of the Ariane 5 rocket. For the time when it was developed, making its debut all the way back in 1996, it was actually quite a well-made and successful heavy-lift vehicle, which is something the industry has had in very short supply. Since that time, the rocket has gone through four variants to improve performance and capability. 117 launches over such a long period of time may not sound like a lot by today's standards, but back before the new era of mega constellations, this served the space industry quite well and ensured that Europe was not reliant on the United States or Russia for a ride into space. Throughout all these launches, the reliable vehicle only suffered two failures and a few more partial failures. Some of the most notable spacecraft that the Ariane 5 was trusted to launch were the ESA's Rosetta mission to the comet known as 67P, becoming the first spacecraft ever to orbit a comet and beam back amazing views of the icy surface in 2014. On November of that same year, the Philae lander detached from Rosetta to attempt the first ever landing on a comet, although the lander eventually bounced off the surface and did not complete its mission successfully. The Jupiter Icy Moons Explorer mission will orbit the Jovian giant for 3 years, performing flybys of the icy moons and studying them for signs of habitable conditions under the icy surface. And finally, the most important mission of them all for Ariane 5 was the James Webb Space Telescope. This flagship NASA satellite was under construction for 30 years and took over $10 billion to build. Because of the distant orbit required for the telescope, there would be no chance to repair it if something ended up going wrong, unlike with the Hubble Space Telescope, which was repaired successfully using the space shuttle. The importance of this telescope cannot be understated. It will massively increase the ability of humanity to learn about our universe for many years to come. However, while it's nice to reminisce about these missions, the reality that we have to face now is Europe has been left without a heavy lift launcher, and the crisis in the overall rocket industry is just growing ever deeper. The planned replacement to this rocket, the Ariane 6, is not yet ready to launch, having encountered development delays, with a first flight originally projected back in 2021. We're now looking at a launch more like 2024. More important than the delayed launch, though, is the fact that the Ariane 6 will be completely expendable, coming online in an era where rockets really need to be reusable in order to compete both on cost and on cadence. How did we get to this point where the brand new flagship European launcher is not even going to attempt reusability, while it is considered by many to be a necessity in order to operate in today's environment? How did we get to the point where the many governments of Europe cannot compete with a single space company that, when it developed a reusable launch vehicle, had an extremely small budget and was trying to attempt something that had never been done before? Well, one clue is this interview given by a managing director for Ariane Space back in the early design phase of the Ariane 6. Let's take a listen.
So today, SpaceX hasn't launched into the geostationary orbit yet, but I mean, they're doing very well and their progress is going forward amazingly well. What I'm discovering in the market, though, is that And SpaceX primarily seems to be selling a dream, which is good. We should all dream. I mean, I think the $5 million launch or $15 million is a bit of the dream. Personally, I think reusability is a dream. So at the moment, I feel that we're looking, and you're presenting to me, how am I going to respond to a dream? And my answer to respond to a dream is, first of all, you don't wake people up. They have to wake up on their own. And then once the market has woken up to the dream and the reality, then we'll compete with that.
But they are looking at a price which is about half yours today.
It's a dream.
Well, all right. Supposing that you wake up and they're there, what would you, Ariane Space, do?
We would have to react to it. I mean, they're not supermen, so whatever they can do, we can do. We would then have to follow.
With all due respect to that executive and to Ariane Space in general, it seems clear to me that he and they are the ones that need to wake up, not SpaceX and the rest of the new commercial launch industry. He said that they would have to respond if SpaceX was successful in their reusability efforts and bringing down the cost of launch. Well, that response is nowhere to be seen many, many years later, with plenty of time for a response to have been formalized and put into action. What is going on here, and why are they still moving forward with an outdated launch vehicle? A few general thoughts come to mind here as I'm thinking about the fate of Ariane 6 and the future of European launch capability. One fact that will always be true is that launch is an extremely strategic and important capability in various governments and countries around the world will always want to have the capability to put items into orbit and into space themselves. So while it may be cheaper for the ESA to put some of their payloads on a Falcon 9 right now, they'll always want to have their own rocket and will never simply rely on commercial vehicles unless those commercial vehicles are located in Europe, made by European companies. So with that being said, it does mean that Ariane 6 can afford to be more expensive than a Falcon 9 on various metrics, and it could still be successful. However, for to me, it doesn't look like it is on the right path. And another problem the agency is likely to run into is all the politics between all these various different countries always coming into play with these government rockets. We see the same thing with SLS. It's just extremely difficult for governments to do anything efficiently when you have politicians fighting to bring as many jobs to their local district, their local area as possible, instead of doing what makes the most fiscal sense for the overall rocket and the overall organization. There is maybe an argument to be said that it could be more efficient for companies in the future to take over all of launch. I don't see that happening, though, because of the aforementioned strategic value of these rockets. Another factor that's really coming into play, and I find quite disturbing, is the massive monopoly SpaceX and the Falcon 9 have really attained over the launch industry. They've really gone from the small startup little guy to almost a monopoly, really an unfair advantage in the industry. Nobody at all is pushing them on price, really. So they can pretty much charge whatever they want, get extremely high margins, and no one can really push forward the industry by driving down those launch costs. When you have one launcher responsible for so much, they don't have an incentive on their own to reduce costs. So I'm really hoping that Rocket Lab and their Neutron, as well as some of these other vehicles, can come in, lower their own prices, and force SpaceX to at least follow suit with their Falcon 9. This is the only way the industry can move forward and launch costs can continue to drop, which is to the benefit of all countries as well as all companies operating in the space industry. I've said before, I'm pretty skeptical about Vulcan being able to push Falcon 9 without reusability, but again, Neutron targeting a lot of reusability, I do have high hopes for. And then the other thought I was struck with as I was watching that video with the executive from the ESA, who I believe has since retired, by the way, but I need to make sure I'm not making the same mistake he is. Now, you all know I'm a Rocket Lab investor. I have a pretty good amount of shares, at least compared to my net worth in the company, so I do watch it very closely, and I want to make sure I'm not burying my head in the sand like he was, believing that SpaceX is not going to hit these extremely, extremely cheap launch costs that we've been hearing about for the Starship. If Starship can really launch for a cheaper cost than a Neutron can, as well as carry way more payload for that launch, then Neutron's in a lot of trouble. And it's never in a very comfortable place betting against someone else, betting that they won't be able to do what they say they can do. It's not usually a position I am comfortable with, especially when you look at a company like SpaceX, which has accomplished so much already in the past. But the one thing I will say Elon and SpaceX have a history of is doing what they say they're going to do, but not really hitting the cost or the timeline that they say they're going to hit. So, yes, Falcon 9 did achieve reusability. Those costs never quite get as low as we imagine they could. Similarly, Elon with his Tesla venture, every time he announces a new electric car, yes, they do eventually roll off the production lines, but it's usually a year or so later at least than they say they're originally going to be produced. And there's usually a significant premium in the cost over the originally announced cost. So I think history is a little bit more in my favor there versus the ESA guy just saying that he doesn't think they'll ever be able to achieve reusability. I'm hoping and believing that they will succeed with the Starship program. I just think it's going to take longer and be more expensive than Elon aspirationally hopes it will. And I do think that in the future of the industry, Starship can be successful and can be extremely important, launching for significantly more than Neutron will launch for, and Neutron will be able to carve out its own smaller niche in the market that nevertheless will still be great for Rocket Lab and its shareholders. Let me know if you agree with me on that one, or if you think I'm out to lunch and I'm just as bad as a dreamer that needs to wake up as that ESA executive was. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing. Every subscriber helps so much continue to grow the channel and encourage me to make more videos. I hope you guys have a great week, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye for now.